A Stranger in Mayfair by Charles Finch. Narrated by James Langton. Copyright 2010 by Charles Finch. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with Charles Finch, care of International Creative Management, and was produced in the year 2011 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. Prologue.
Clara, who is that gentleman? He looks familiar.
The question startled Clara Woodward, a slender, light-haired girl, out of her deep reverie. They had been sitting silently for 10 minutes, and she had used most of the time to ponder the limitless wonders of her friend Harold Webb. His gentle good looks, his kind smile, his intelligent eyes, the dashing cut of his clothes. It was hopeless. He was in London, and here she was in the entrance hall of a hotel in Paris. While to another girl this might have seemed wonderful, it was quite a grand, ancient hotel, the Crillon, situated handsomely on the Place de la Concorde, and the hall itself was opulent, gilded and hung with old tapestries. To Clara, it seemed a tragedy. With an inward sigh, she turned her attention to her Aunt Bess.
Which one do you mean?
The rather tall and thin one, with the brown hair.
Clara turned her gaze across the hotel's lobby.
And the short beard? That's Charles Lenox, I believe.
In fact, she knew it perfectly well. Two or three people had pointed him out to her, and she had once met him at a party in Belgravia.
I know he just recently married Lady...
Lady Jane Grey, yes, yes, I remember him now. They do let anybody into this hotel. It's shocking, most shocking.
What's wrong with him, Aunt?
From everything I hear, he's a fearfully low sort. Consorts with common criminals. I know he calls himself a detective, of all things.
I think she's very beautiful. I saw her in the restaurant.
Lady Jane Grey?
Doubt clouded the older woman's brow.
I always heard she was of good stock, of course. Your late uncle once rode to hounds with her father, the Earl of Horton, about 10 years ago, I think. Yes, in 1854 or 1855, I feel quite sure. I never heard a single good thing of Charles Lennox, though, you may be certain of that. For one thing, his closest friend is Thomas McConnell.
Clara looked blank.
Is that so bad?
My dear, he married far above himself, and he drinks like a fish. What do you say to a man who has a drunk for a near friend?
There was ever so much fuss when Mr. Lennox stopped that man at the Mint from stealing all that money. Do you remember? The murdered journalists?
He probably murdered them himself,
said Bess in a complacent tone.
Whether it wanted to or not, she was determined to watch the world slide into iniquity. The amateur detective, for such he was, and would own it much more proudly than someone like Bess, who thought it a betrayal of his birth, would prefer, paced across the marble floor of the hall. It was otherwise empty, too early in the afternoon for people to be at their tea. Clara thought gloomily of all the hotel's other residents, out buying lovely dresses, and drinking lovely wine, and seeing lovely gardens. In truth, she knew far more of London and its society than her aunt ever could, and now she pulled out her trump card. She rather liked the look of Lennox, and adored the style and beauty of his new wife.
"Wasn't he just elected to Parliament, Aunt?" she said sweetly.
Bess dismissed this with a scowl.
"Oh! Anyone is in Parliament these days, Clara. It's a disgrace. No, what matters is that for all his adult life, he has been a detective. It's the lowest thing I ever heard, I swear."
Clara was only half listening, however, because her own mention of Parliament had recalled Harold to her again. Parliament was his ambition, and whatever he wanted, she did too, passionately. It was hopeless, she repeated to herself, utterly hopeless. And for the silliest reason. It wasn't because he didn't reciprocate her affection.
He did, which made her heart flutter to contemplate. Unfortunately, he hadn't any money, and though it didn't matter a whit to her, her parents, who controlled her own marriage portion, had forbidden the match. Thus she was in Paris, out of London, her home city, and with her tedious, countrified aunt, who lived primarily in Kent and spent only a month of the year in town. "It will be nice for her and nice for you," her parents had said. They weren't cruel people, but oh, how cruelly they were behaving.
"I remember now," said her aunt. "George Barnard was the master of the mint, and he was trying to steal from it. But surely it was Scotland Yard who solved that mystery, wasn't it?" "Yes, I remember very definitely that it was Scotland Yard."
"But everyone in London knows that it was really Charlie Lennox," said Clara. "He never takes the credit, and he goes to the best places, I promise you."
"What's the world coming to?" said Bess,
rolling her eyes heavenward.
"Of course it's only because he's taking advantage of poor Lady Jane. Charmed her, I'm sure, with his slick ways. And now she's burdened with him for good. Oh, dear, the thought of it!"
Bess fanned herself fretfully.
"They're lifelong friends, I believe. They lived in houses side by side for years before he proposed. I think it's wonderfully romantic."
"Clara Woodward, you're determined to vex me, aren't you? Why won't girls listen to sense these days? A detective, no matter what society he sees, or how many parliaments he's in, is the least savoury, vilest, most evil-minded—"
But here she broke off, because the unsavoury, vile, evil-minded man himself was walking toward them from across the hall. It was a wide room, dotted with tables and sofas, with gold leaf everywhere and vast trees dimming the noise. Or at any rate, Bess prayed they dimmed the noise. The man's face was friendly enough. Perhaps he hadn't heard her.
"How do you do? I'm afraid that I must presume on very slight acquaintance to reintroduce myself to your niece. I'm Charles Lennox."
"How do you do, Mr. Lennox? My name is Bess Telford. You've met my niece?"
"Once, yes, but only very briefly, as I recall, and I'm ashamed to say I don't remember her name. Your name, ma'am?" he said, turning to Clara.
"This is Clara Woodward,"
said Bess, simpering a little. The Earls of Horton, after all. And now she seemed to recall something about an older brother, too. Was it Edward Lennox? Edmund Lennox? A leading man in Parliament?
"As I say, I must apologize for presuming upon our very brief first meeting, but I was wondering whether either of you had seen my wife here. I was 5 minutes late to meet her, and now it's been 15 minutes. The clerks didn't spy her, but I thought you might have."
"Oh, how worrisome! I haven't seen her, I'm sorry to say, and in this city what might happen to an honest Englishwoman is anybody's."
"I haven't seen her either," said Clara, to save her aunt's solecism. For her efforts she earned a reproving look from her relation. "Did you see the Robinsons before you left London?" This was their mutual acquaintance.
"I did, yes, they—"
Determined not to be superseded by her niece, however, Bess said,
"Remind me, Mr. Lennox, about the affair at the Mint. Wasn't it you who sent that wicked man Barnard away to prison and saved all of our money?"
Lennox turned red, and Clara felt she could have sunk into the ground.
"Ah, I recall the incident to which I believe you're referring, ma'am. But it was not I, it was Scotland Yard, that apprehended the criminal."
"And that September Society?"
Thankfully for Lennox, at that moment Lady Jane Grey burst into the lobby, trailed by a small French girl in a dressmaker's uniform, some sort of apprentice, carrying a parcel under her arm.
"Charles," cried out Lady Jane, "there you are. Whatever punctuality I ever could claim has been stolen from me by this city. I'm so sorry, but do introduce me, please, to your friends."
She was a lovely woman, though not immediately striking. She was plainly dressed, in a simple blue gown with a grey ribbon at the waist, and her dark curls looked natural, not affected. What Clara noticed, however, was the tremendous poise and wisdom of her eyes, and the faint lattice of wrinkles around them. She must have been 35 or 36. Lennox himself was 40, or just past. After all the proper introductions had been effected, and Bess had regaled the company at length with the story of that day hunting with Lady Jane's father in 1854 or 1855, Lennox invited the pair to dine with them the next night. When this plan was agreed, he and his wife left, looking, Clara thought, with a feeling of melancholy, as pink-faced and happy and thrilled as all newlyweds should. She listened to her aunt expatiate on Lady Jane's virtues, and then heard her conclude, "And really, he doesn't seem all that bad, for a detective, I mean, for a detective." Chapter 1. For an Englishman, it was a strange time to be in France. During much of the century, a strong enmity had existed between the country's two governments, first because of Napoleon's rather uncouth attempt to conquer Europe, then because of the lingering hostility born of that time. Now, though, the emperor's nephew ruled France and had shown himself more liberal than his uncle. He had freed the press and the government from many of their previous restrictions, and an uneasy peace had sprung up across the Channel. Even during the worst of times, just after Waterloo, for instance, there had been civility among open-minded French and Englishmen, and now a man like Lennox, who loved so much about France, its coffee, its food, its wine, its architecture, its countryside, its literature, could visit the place with open admiration. There were republican rumblings in the capital, however, and many Frenchmen whose grandfathers had survived the Revolution felt fearful of what the next years might bring. Both Lennox and Lady Jane were happy that they had come when they did. Who knew what changes another shift in regime might bring? Who knew whether they would ever be able to visit again? And since that was the case, they had done all they could. Lady Jane had ordered dresses by the dozen, the seamstresses here being so infinitely preferable to English dressmakers. Even at the height of the war, fashion had been smuggled from one country to the other. While Lennox had spent his days closeted with a dozen different politicians, all of them sympathetic. For he was, in fact, the newly minted Member of Parliament for Stirrington, had been elected not 6 months since. In that time, he had barely entered the Great Chamber, however. He and Lady Jane had married in the Whitsun recess, and now, in the summer recess, they were on their honeymoon. Paris was their final destination. They had spent 3 weeks travelling through the beautiful lake towns of the Alps, then another 2 in the French countryside. In truth, as wonderful as it had been, both longed to be home. They missed London, missed their friends, and missed the little street off Grosvenor Square, Hampden Lane, where they had lived in side-by-side townhouses for the better part of 2 decades. When they returned, the 2 houses would be one. Over the past months, an architect had supervised the demolition of the walls between them and seamlessly joined the building's rooms to create 1 large house. It gave Lennox a good deal of private pleasure to contemplate this physical symbol of their union. For long years, Jane had been his closest friend, and he could scarcely believe that he was lucky enough now to be married to her. Their births were close enough, hers slightly higher, and they had grown up together, but within London society she was one of the brightest stars, and while he was welcome everywhere and had a great variety of friends, he was viewed as idiosyncratic because of his career. Perhaps his marriage and his admission to Parliament would change that. He hated to admit it, but he wouldn't mind. It had been hard to go it alone for so long in the face of everyone's polite disapproval of his vocation. That evening, they were in their sitting room at the Crillon. She was at a small carved desk, writing her correspondence, and he was sitting in an armchair reading. A cool summer breeze blew in through the window. as if she were reading his mind. She looked up and said, "To think, in 3 days we'll be home." "I can't wait," he said quietly and ardently. "I've had a letter from Toto. She's simply enormous," she says, "and she and Thomas seem to be quite content together. What does she say?" "Here it is. Thomas and I sit together in the evenings. I knit and he reads, except when we both stop and talk about baby names, and what room to give the child, and, oh, everything. That sounds like Toto, doesn't it? She writes just the way she speaks." Bess Telford's facts had been mingled with rumours. Thomas McConnell was a doctor and occasionally did drink too much. A talented surgeon, from a family of minor nobility in Scotland, he had come to London to practice in Harley Street, and shortly thereafter, almost to his surprise, married one of the most admired young women in the city. Lady Victoria Phillips was born with beauty and immense fortune, and in personality she was entirely winning, effervescent, affectionate, gossiping, and slightly silly. But she was also young. While their marriage had been happy for 3 years, after that it had become first an acrimonious and then a terrible one, full of fights and cold silences. For a period of 2 years, the couple barely spoke, and Toto spent much of her time at her parents' house in the country. It was during this time that Thomas had begun to drink. Shamed by his wife's family into selling his practice for a song to a Phillips cousin, it wasn't considered fitting that the husband of Toto Phillips should be a professional man. His subsequent aimlessness had been cruel to his spirit. It was only within the last year or two that Toto and Thomas's relationship had healed, and her pregnancy, which was why, 8 months in, she could describe herself as enormous, was just the final bond they needed to restore them to happiness. The trouble between them had been terrible to Lennox and Lady Jane. Thomas was Charles's medical assistant when a case demanded it, and besides that, a close friend. And as for Jane, Toto was a cousin of hers, and more like a niece than any of Jane's actual nieces. The couple's renewed closeness was a massive relief. Toto's series of letters had been more and more happy with each one, as the birth of her baby came closer and closer.
"Where will she go for the birth?" asked Lennox.
"I believe they intend to stay in London."
"I would have thought they might go to her father's house."
"In a way, I'm glad they won't. It's always been too easy for Toto to flee to her family. Perhaps it's a sign that she's growing up."
Lennox stood. "Shall we go to dinner soon?" he asked.
"I'd rather just stay in, if you don't mind."
He smiled.
"Of course."
The next morning was August 25, the day in France of the Feast of St. Louis. By more than a century's tradition, it was also the day the famous Salon opened at the Louvre Palace, and the greatest artists of France, and indeed the world, displayed their year's work. Lennox and Lady Jane went early, heard Napoleon III speak, and spent a long day looking around. People surrounded a painting by Manet and another by Whistler, and while Lennox admired these profoundly, he soon found himself steering away from the crowds and toward the back rooms. Here he found in one dim corner a series of 3 extremely blurred, thick-painted canvases of sunrise, even less distinct than Manet's. They seemed to be little more than evocations of figure and light. He stared at them for half an hour, and after consulting his new wife, bought one, the littlest one, which was blue and orange. That evening, they dined with Bess and Clara, and the next day they took a trip to the country and toured a small town with one of the politicians Lennox had met, who represented the district the town belonged to. Then, just like that, it was all over. They had to wake very early the next morning to finish the packing their servants had begun and send their luggage off. By 9 o'clock, they were in a carriage on the way to Calais, and by noon, they were aboard their ferry. It was summer, but for some reason the channel was extremely foggy, and as they stood on deck, a wet, grey wind swirled around them.
"It seems like a dream, doesn't it?" said Lady Jane. "I feel as if we left yesterday. But think of all those beautiful Swiss villages, Charles. Think of that 100-foot waterfall."
We ate in that restaurant on the mountainside. And our guide when we went up there. It was a wonderful trip, he said, leaning on the rail. But I'm glad we're going home. I'm ready to be married in London now.
She laughed her clear, low laugh and said, I am too. He hadn't been quite joking. He stole a glance at Jane, and his heart filled with happiness. For years he had thought himself a happy man, indeed had been happy and fortunate in his friendships, his work, his interests, his family. But now he understood that in that entire time something vital had been missing. It was she. This was a new kind of happiness. It wasn't only the mawkish love of penny fiction, though that was there. It was also a feeling of deep security in the universe, which derived from the knowledge of an equal soul and spirit going through life together with you. From time to time, he thought his heart would break, it made him so glad, and felt so precarious, so new, so unsure. A mild, wispy rain started to fall when they were nearly across the water. Jane went inside, but Lennox said he thought he might stay out and look. And he was lucky to have done so. At certain times in our lives, we all feel grateful for one outworn idea or another, and now was one of those times for Lennox. As the fog cleared, he saw much closer and bigger than he had expected the vast, pristine white face of the cliffs of Dover come into view. It made him feel he was home, just like Jane did. Chapter 2. It was fortunate that the man who had designed and built the 10 houses along Hampden Lane in 1788 had built them to the same scale, albeit in different configurations. Lennox's and Lady Jane's houses both had 12-foot-deep basements where the staff could work and live, 8-step front stairs that led to broad front doors. His was red, hers white. 4 floors of rooms and a narrow back garden. It meant they fit together. Still, to join them had taken a great deal of ingenuity on the part of a young builder named, aptly enough, Stackhouse. On the first floor he had knocked down the wall between their 2 dining rooms, creating a single long hall, which could now entertain 50 people or so. More importantly, it had left intact the 2 most important rooms in the house, Lady Jane's sitting room, a rose-coloured square where she entertained her friends and took her tea, and Lennox's study, a long, lived-in chamber full of overstuffed armchairs, with books lining every surface and a desk piled under hundreds of papers and trinkets. Its high windows looked over the street, and on the opposite end its fireplace was where Lennox sat with his friends. Upstairs there was a large new bedroom for them, and on the 3rd floor 2 small parlours became a very nice billiard room for Lennox. In the basement, the builders only made a slim hallway between the houses, firstly so as not to tamper with the foundation, and secondly because the couple didn't need as much space down there. They were reducing their staff. They only required 1 coachman now, 2 footmen, 1 cook, Lennox's Ellie was foul-mouthed but talented, and 1 boot boy. Lady Jane's cook gave notice, explaining that it was excellent timing, since she and her husband had always hoped to open a pub, and now had the money. Still, it would leave 4 people out of work. Fortunately, Lady Jane's brother always needed servants, and those who wanted to move from London to the country received their new billets happily. 3 of them took this offer, and the 4th, a bright young lad who had been Lennox's coachman, took 2 months' pay and set out for South Africa to make his fortune, with a letter of introduction from his now former employer. All of this still left 1 enormous problem. The butlers. Both Lennox and Lady Jane had long-serving butlers, who seemed half part of the family. In fact, it was unusual for a woman to have a butler rather than a housekeeper, but Jane had insisted on it when she first came to London, and now Kirk, an extremely fat, extremely dignified Yorkshireman, had been with her for nearly 20 years. More seriously, there was Graham. For all of Lennox's adult life,
Graham had been his butler, and more importantly, his confidant and companion. They had met when Lenox was a student and Graham a scout at Balliol College. Special circumstances had bound them there, and when Lenox left for London, he had taken Graham with him. He had fetched Lennox his morning coffee, yes, but Graham had also helped him in a dozen of his cases, campaigned for him in Stirrington, and travelled with him across Europe and to Russia. Now, all that might change. So when Lennox returned to London, he went over the new house with an awed, pleased eye. It was just as he had imagined it being, but with the consciousness as well that he had to confront the problem of Graham. The next morning, he had a rather radical idea. He rang the bell, and soon Graham appeared with a breakfast tray laden with eggs, ham, kippers, and toast, a pot of fragrant black coffee to the side. He was a compact, sandy-haired, and intelligent-looking man.
"Good morning, Graham."
"Good morning, sir. May I welcome you back, less formally, to London?"
The previous night, the servants had lined the hall and curtsied and bowed in turn to the newlyweds, then presented them with the wedding present of a silver teapot.
"Thanks. That's awfully kind of you. It's a wonderful pot. Graham, would you sit down and keep me company for a moment? You don't mind if I eat, do you? Fetch yourself a cup and have some of this coffee, if you like."
Graham shook his head at the offer, but sat down in the armchair across from Lennox, an act that would have drawn gasps from many of Lennox's acquaintances for its familiarity. They made idle chat about Switzerland as Lennox gulped down coffee and eggs, until at last, sated, he pushed his plate away and sat happily back, patting the crimson dressing gown over his stomach.
"How long have we known each other, Graham?" asked Lennox.
21 years, sir."
"Is it really that long?" "Yes, I suppose I was 18. It scarcely seems credible. 21 years. We've grown middle-aged together, haven't we?"
"Indeed, sir."
"I just got married, Graham."
The butler, who had been at the wedding, allowed himself the ghost of a smile.
"I heard something of it, sir."
"Did you never consider it?"
"Once, sir, but the lady's affections were otherwise engaged."
"I'm sorry to hear it."
"It was many years ago, sir, when we still lived in Oxford."
"Have you been happy in your employment?"
"Yes, sir."
Graham was an understated man, but he said this emphatically.
"Both in my daily duties and in the less usual ones you have asked me to perform, Mr. Lennox."
"I'm glad to hear it. You don't fancy a change of work?"
"No, sir. Not in the slightest."
"You mustn't look so stony-faced, Graham. I'm not firing you, not by a long shot. Remind me, what papers do you read?"
"Excuse me?"
"What newspapers do you read?"
"The House subscribes to."
"No, Graham, not the House. You."
"Below stairs we take the Times and the Manchester Guardian, sir. In my spare hours I usually read both."
"Does anyone else read them downstairs?"
Graham looked discomfited.
"Well, no, sir."
"You know as much about politics as I do, or very nearly,"
murmured Lennox, more to himself than his companion.
"Sir?"
"May I shock you, Graham?"
"Yes, sir."
"I want you to come work for me."
The butler very nearly laughed.
"Sir?"
Lennox sighed, stood up, and began pacing the study.
"I've been troubled during all my time on the continent about the business of a secretary. I interviewed 8 candidates, all young men just up from Cambridge or Oxford, all of them of excellent family, and eager to be personal secretary to a gentleman in Parliament. The trouble was that I felt that each one of them was sizing me up to decide when they could have my seat. They were all too ambitious, Graham. Or perhaps that's not it. Perhaps it's simply that I didn't know them, and I didn't want to risk getting to know them as they worked for me."
"You cannot be suggesting, sir."
"You read more than half the men sitting in Parliament, Graham. More importantly, I trust you.
Lennox walked up to the study's row of high windows, his slippers softly padding the thick rug. He stared into the bright, summery street for a few moments.
I want you to come be my secretary.
Graham stood up too now, quite clearly agitated.
If I may speak freely, sir.
Yes?
It is an utterly impossible request. As gratified as I am at your consideration, Mr. Lennox, I am in no way suited to such a role that belongs to someone from the great universities, someone with far more education than I possess, and, if I may speak frankly, sir, someone of your own class.
I'm not trying to change the world. I simply want someone I can trust.
Graham swallowed.
As a solution to a simple staffing problem, sir, I must say I find it exceedingly inelegant.
Lennox waved an irritated hand.
No, no. I want both you and Kirk to be happy, of course, but it's more than that. For one thing, you've been overqualified by your natural merits for years. More to the point, more selfishly, I'm new at this. I need help.
At last Graham was silent. Finally he said,
I'm honored, sir.
Will you do it?
I cannot say, sir. May I have time to consider the proposal?
Yes, of course.
Would I still live here?
If you liked, yes. You shall always have lodging while I draw breath, as you well know.
And if I say no, sir, what will become of me then?
Grumpily Lennox said,
Well, we'd keep both of you, of course, and we'd hire 5 more butlers just to make sure we had one in every room.
Now Graham did laugh.
Thank you, sir.
Before you get above your old station, would you mind helping me with this painting?
It was the one from the salon, the blurry one. The 2 men pried its crate open, took its wrappings off, and then walked it down to the dining hall. There they hung it, tilting it imperceptibly back and forth until it was just level.
May I ask who painted it? Graham asked.
A chap named Monnet, said Lennox. Rhymes with bonnet, I think. I never heard of him myself. Funny, the picture looked better over in Paris.
Such is often the case with these flashy continental objects, sir,
said Graham, with evident disapproval. As they got the picture hung just right, there was a knock at the door. Through the troubling weeks that followed, Lennox sometimes wished he and Graham had ignored that knock and the ominous events it portended. Chapter 3. The gentleman's name was Ludovic Starling. Lennox had known him for a decade. Nevertheless, it was a surprise to find him at the door, for there was little acquaintance between the 2 men. Ludo was through and through a son of Wiltshire, with a family that had sat obstinately on the same plot of land there since the Restoration, when one of Ludo's progenitors had remained covertly loyal to the king. This man, Cheshire Starling, a blacksmith, had received 600 prime acres in thanks for printing 12 copies of a single handbill that denounced, with dazzlingly poor syntax, Oliver Cromwell and his people. With a grant of £300, Cheshire had erected a tidy L-shaped hall, and the generations that had succeeded him in it had been filled with dull, pasty, and despite their fanciful surname, heavy-footed men. The Starling women had just as little enterprise, and in all, the family had been content to remain just as they were, year after year, and decade after decade. Century after century. No Starling was ever too dismal a failure, or too great a success, and the little parcel of family money never dipped or rose too high in value. The cousins were all looked after. They were a comfortable, pointless clan. Until Ludovic, that is. About Lennox's age, he had gone up to university as a willowy, handsome, ambitious lad of 17. From there, he had moved to London, and by the age of 30, had through his marriage attained a seat in Parliament.
His father-in-law was a Scottish lord with land in Kintyre and a district in Pocket. Since then, Ludo had been a reliable backbencher, and more recently had assumed a prominent position in his party's hierarchy. He had also gained weight, and was now a red-faced, sturdy and social creature who loved to drink and play cards. A year before, he had inherited Starling Hall, an only child, but hadn't visited it since his father's funeral. All this Lenox knew, by the way, just as well as he knew a thousand other short biographies of his London acquaintanceship.
"Why, Ludo, what can I do for you?"
asked Lenox, who had come down the hall and watched Graham open the door.
"There you are, Charles. I'm sorry to pop up unannounced like this."
Graham left, and Lenox shepherded Ludo into the study to sit.
"You're very welcome, of course. How is Elizabeth?"
"Quite well, thanks. A bit unsure of what to do with herself, with Alfred at Cambridge and Paul following him in the fall. They're both here for the summer holidays at the moment, at least."
"Following in their father's footsteps, at Downing, I take it? Here, come into my study. Have you come about Parliament? I'm to meet with a group of gentlemen this afternoon to discuss our position in the colonies. I expressed an interest on the subject, and James Hillary was kind enough to include me."
Ludo shook his head.
"No, not that at all. Congratulations, by the way."
"Thanks."
"In fact, I've come for another reason. A lad in my house has been killed."
"My God."
"Not in my house,"
Ludo hastened to add. He was restless, anxious. In Lennox's study, he stood up and paced back and forth.
"A lad of my house, I should have said. In fact, his actual demise took place in an alley just behind us, off of South Audley."
"Who was it?"
"Not anyone I knew well. A young man named Clark, Frederick Clark, who worked for me. He was only 19.
"How was he killed?"
"Bludgeoned to death. There was no weapon at the scene, apparently."
"The yard is in?"
"Oh, yes. It happened last night. Two constables are there now, keeping people clear of the area. I came to see you because, well, because I know you've worked as a detective in the past. Kept your cases very quiet, too."
"This young man, Frederick Clark, worked for you?"
"Yes, as a footman. His mother, Marie, was our housekeeper briefly about 15 years ago. Almost as soon as she came into our service, she inherited something from her family and moved back to her hometown to open a pub. Apparently her son wanted to come to London, and she wrote asking if we might take him on. So, of course, we said yes."
"Decent of you."
"Elizabeth has a long memory for these things. You know how kind she is. He's been with us for 4 years now, but I spend so much time at the house and at the turf."
This was his club, whose membership consisted largely of sportsmen and card players.
"That I don't know all the faces."
4 years, thought Lenox. It seemed impossible to live under the same roof as a person for so long without knowing him through and through.
"You didn't know him, or you didn't know him well?"
"Didn't know him well, I should have said. Of course, I knew his face and exchanged a few words with him here and there. But Eliza is very upset, and I promised her that I would ask for your help. She's the reason I'm here, in fact. Although we were both relieved when we remembered you had just gotten back into town."
"Oh?"
Ludo's face flushed, and his tone became confidential.
"In truth, I wouldn't mind it quietly handled, and I know I can count on your discretion. Quite between you and me, there has been some talk of a title."
"A title for you?"
asked Lenox, surprised. A title usually capped a career. Ludo was still young, or at least middle-aged.
"I've been a guest at the palace quite often recently, and play whist with one of the royals almost every night. I won't say his name, but apparently my service in Parliament has been observed and may be commended."
"I congratulate you."
It would please me immensely, I don't mind saying. It always rather rankled in our family that the old king didn't hand us something in that line. God bless him," he added, as an afterthought.
This was puzzlingly intimate, thought Lenox, and then asked,
"Why must it be quiet? Surely there's no implication that you killed the boy?"
"I? Never," Ludo laughed. "Besides, having no reason on earth to do it, I was sat firmly at the card table for 10 hours last night, with Frank Derbyshire and a whole host of others.
Of course, I didn't mean—"
"It's only that the slightest breath of scandal or infelicity can shake this sort of thing. It's all so fragile, you know."
"The title?"
"Yes, exactly. Also, as I say, Eliza is quite upset, most upset, and asked me to come."
Lennox was puzzled by Ludo's behaviour. Did he care about this lad, Frederick Clark? Why not let the Yard handle it? And why was he bursting with all this information about his prospects for an elevation to the House of Lords? It seemed in awfully poor taste. Then it occurred to Lennox that perhaps Ludo couldn't share any of this potential good fortune with his friends, or even his family, lest it fall through and make him look like a liar or a fool. It might be that he needed an audience, someone who would listen with appropriate gravity to the news, but who would keep it to himself. Yes, Lennox decided, it was because the man had run over the tantalizing facts so often in his mind, and needed to blurt them out to stay sane, had been bursting with the news. Strange indeed, though, to deliver it as he simultaneously delivered news of a murder. He was terribly restless.
"Here, sit," said Lennox.
At last Ludo settled into the armchair Graham had only recently occupied, opposite Lennox and in front of the cold hearth.
"Thanks, thanks," he said. "Now, may I bring you back with me? My carriage is outside."
"I'm honoured that you came to me, but it's the worst possible moment for me to take on any new responsibilities."
"You mean you can't come look?"
"I wish I could, but I cannot. The leaders of our party have made allowances because of my marriage, but as you well know, the House reconvenes in little more than a week's time, and there are meetings for me to attend hour after hour before then."
"If it's about money."
Shocked, Lennox drew himself up in his chair and said,
"No, it isn't."
Ludo saw straight away that he had made a blunder.
"I'm so terribly sorry. Of course it isn't about money. Forgive me."
"As I say, my responsibilities at the moment scarcely permit me any return to my old field. You of all people can understand how daunting it is to be a new member."
"Yes, of course."
"The Yard is competent in these matters, I promise."
Ludo, still agitated, said,
"Are you sure you couldn't come and have a quick look?"
In fact, Lennox was sorely tempted to do it. He missed his old work and, excited though he was about his new career, contemplated with mute dread the idea of giving detection up forever. Even while he had been on the continent, absorbed by Jane and the local life, his mind had often turned back to old cases. Still, he said,
"No, I'm afraid—"
"Oh, please, Lennox, if only for my wife. She has no peace of mind at all just now."
"But—"
"We must look out for each other, members of the Commons. I wouldn't ask if I weren't distressed."
Lennox relented.
"Just a look. Then perhaps I'll pass it on to my student, John Dallington, and he can delve into the matter if he chooses. Come along. I must hurry. That meeting about the colonies is in 2 hours."
Chapter 4. As he had 1 foot hiked up into Starling's carriage, a massive black conveyance with the family crest worked into its doors, a slightly low thing to have if you weren't a duke, perhaps, Lennox had the novel realization that for the first time since he was a boy, he had a duty to keep someone apprised of his whereabouts. Stepping back down, he grinned to himself. He was a married man now. How wonderful to contemplate!
Jane was on one of the thousand social visits that occupied weekday mornings, making the rounds in her own old, slightly battered, and extremely homey carriage. She would be back soon, however.
"Just one moment, Ludo," said Lennox, and dashed inside.
He found Graham, and asked him to tell Lady Jane where he was going. Between this and the meeting, it would be nearly supper before he returned.
"Yes, sir," said Graham. "Here, sir, your—"
"Ah, my watch. Don't think I've forgotten our conversation, by the by. Will you think about it?"
"Of course, sir."
"Since you're still a butler for the moment, however, don't forget to tell Jane where I am."
Lennox laughed, and stepped quickly back out to join Ludo. He realized as he laughed that his spirits had lightened with the prospect of a new case. They went through Mayfair at a rapid trot. It was Lennox's home neighborhood, the one in which he felt most comfortable, and much of his adult life had been spent inside this stretch of London from Piccadilly to Hyde Park. As it had been for the past century or so, it was a fashionable place, the most expensive part of the city, with faddish restaurants, white-glove hotels, and a gentle, calm aspect. The boulevards were wide and uncrowded, the houses well-kept, and the shops tidy and pleasant. In some parts of London one felt quite hemmed in on the narrow streets, with carriages brushing by each other and mongers shouting to sell their fruit or fish, but Mayfair seemed somehow more civilized. It certainly wasn't a quarter of London that Lennox associated with murder. Though the practice was all but dead, you'd still be more likely to see a duel between gentlemen in Green Park than any bloody-minded killing. The carriage stopped a few hundred feet short of Curzon Street, where the Starling townhouse stood just off a corner. Ludo, who hadn't spoken during the trip, rapped the side of the carriage with his walking stick.
"Here it is," he said to Lennox as they stepped out. "The alley. Many of the servants on Curzon Street use it every day to do their errands. These constables have heard a fair bit of back chat from upset housemaids wanting to get by."
It was a narrow lane, the width of only two or three people, and slightly suffocating because the two brick walls that closed it off reached up 5 and 6 stories. South Audley Street, a busy thoroughfare, was bright and summery, full of people, but as Lennox peered down the lane, it looked dim and sooty.
"What time of day did it happen?"
"In the evening, apparently. It's far busier during the day than at night. A young girl came across the body at 8:30 and immediately fetched the officer at the end of the road."
Lennox nodded. It was an affluent neighbourhood, of course, and as such would have been swarming with bobbies. The alley might have been the only place for blocks where an assailant could risk an assault without being immediately seized.
"Let's walk down and have a look."
The alley was 50 or 60 feet long, and halfway down that length a single constable stood. He was a tall, burly, and reassuring sort. It had been some time since Lennox had visited the site of a murder, and he had somehow forgotten, as one always did, the eerie feeling of it.
"Hello, Mr. Johnson," said Ludo. "Where did your Mr. Campbell go?"
"Back to his beat, sir. We had the inspector out, and he said only one person needed to stay here."
"To see if anyone returned to the scene?" Lennox asked.
"Yes, sir. Can't quite see the point myself, when there are 30 people clamouring to get in every minute or so."
"At any rate, I'm glad you've kept the scene intact this long. Which inspector was it?"
"With all politeness and that, sir, I didn't catch your name."
"I'm Charles Lennox, Constable Johnson."
The man's ruddy face lit up.
"Lennox the detective?" he said brightly.
"That's right."
"You ought to have said so. We're all right grateful down the yard that you caught that bastard Barnard. Excusing my language, sir,"
he added, nodding to Ludo.
"Not at all."
Barnard had ordered killed, a famous police inspector, a man by the name of Exeter. Lennox had uncovered the deed.
"Thank you," said Lennox, "although I must say that my role was extremely minor. The yard did the vast majority of the work."
Johnson grinned and tapped his nose.
"Our secret, sir," he said.
"But I heard Inspector Jenkins tell about it all, sir. All of it,"
he added significantly. Ludo looked at the pair slightly irritably, as if he suddenly suspected that Lenox might get a title now, and there was only one to be had.
"Would you mind if Mr. Lenox looked at the spot?" he asked.
"Not at all. Down this way, sir."
The genial tone of their conversation abruptly changed as they came upon the scene of the murder.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.